So welcome to today's session, okay, which is the demo on Oracle Fusion Financials. Before we get into this actual session, if you have any quick questions, you can ask me. We'll talk on that, then we'll proceed with the agenda for demo. Any quick questions on this course, please? Anyone?
Hi, Lakshman.
So there is a lot of noise from someone, so just 7.
Yeah, just I want to know what is the course duration and what is the coverage, what is the scope?
Yeah, that everything we'll be discussing within this. Okay, that would be as a part of today's agenda. Any other questions, please? Any other quick questions? Fine. Yeah, Anvesh, any question from your end? Okay, seems to no questions as of now. Okay, we'll just look into the questions, if anything, from anyone. So we'll just get into the actual demo session. So as a part of demo, these are the few points I taken for the discussion. So first we'll talk about what is a Fusion applications. After understanding what is a Fusion applications, we'll discuss about, okay, the Fusion applications, so what is the difference between on-premise and cloud? And if we are going to implement any solution for client, so what are the different implementation models we have as a part of Fusion applications? We'll see that, and we'll understand about what is the arch structure in the Fusion, and we'll talk on few points, what would be the role of functional and technical consultants in Fusion application. Then finally we'll talk about the course curriculum which we designed for this training. So these are the few points I'll take you through in the today's session, and further sessions we have a few more points, we'll talk on that respectively. Okay, so the first point, what is Fusion applications, what Fusion applications all about? So we know very well these are the top ERP products which you see in the market: Oracle E-Business Suite and JD Edwards, Siebel, PeopleSoft, SAP, and there are a few other ERP products which we can find in the market. But when you look at any ERP product, okay, take example of Oracle, JD Edwards, Siebel, PeopleSoft, SAP, can you tell me which product is best for all the areas of business? I mean to say, like, take financial, supply chain management, HRMS, okay, customer relationship management. If I ask you the question, which is the best ERP product in the market to cater the best needs of any organization? Okay, for this question answer, definitely you cannot name any one of the ERP. The reason is, so there is no one ERP in the market which will give the best solution, okay, for the different areas of the business. Okay, I can hear some noise from someone. If you don't mind, please mute from your end. If you have any question, you can unmute and you can ask me. Still, I can hear some noise. Okay. Generally, this we can get from the guys who are joining from their mobile device. Please recheck from your end. Please. Still, I can hear. Let me try from my end. Give me a second. Okay. It's done. So there is no such a ERP in the market which will give the best, okay, quality of solution. It's the best solution for all the areas of the business. When you look at Oracle ERP, okay, Oracle EBS, So entire, see, Oracle EBS, within the Oracle EBS, or say from Oracle ERP, we have a different solutions: financials, SCM and procurement and HRMS, projects. Many solutions are available, but out of that, the best solution from Oracle EBS is financials. And when I talk about JD Edwards, from JD Edwards, procurement is the best. You can say procurement solution is very good. And when I look at Siebel, okay, it's a best for CRM. So JD Edwards, Siebel also offering other solutions also, but out of all the solutions which these products are offering, the best, there is a best piece of solution that we are talking about. When I talk about PeopleSoft is very famous for HCM, nothing but HRMS solution. When I talk about SAP, the best solution from SAP is primarily SD, sales and distribution. So this is how we have a different ERP products, and each product is specialized for a specific business area. So if any client is going to implement ERP, which ERP they have to choose? Okay, which ERP they have to choose? That is a big question. If they go with Oracle, they can get financials as a best solution. But the same time, if they have a just a, I mean a kind of a primary business focus is going to be on HCM related solutions also, definitely they cannot get from Oracle. In that case, they have to choose for their HCM solution, HCM, PeopleSoft, and procurement some other ERP product, which is a very challenging for any client. So for each and every solution, they cannot go with the different ERP products. So that will become very complex in terms of managing the systems and taking the, I mean, what I can say, like license from the different one vendors. So that is the reason that just one company cannot go with the multiple ERP products, because they are running the business in the, they have a different areas of business which they are running. So you know, like this is the situation we can see in the market. What Oracle it is, they acquired many ERP products. Okay, so what Oracle it is anyway, Oracle is well specialized in financial services, and Oracle acquired JD Edwards and Siebel CRM and PeopleSoft and many other ERP products also Oracle acquired. After acquiring all these ERP products, what Oracle it is, they've taken financial solution from EBS, from JD Edwards they've taken procurement, from Siebel they've taken CRM solution, from PeopleSoft they've taken HCM solution. In the same way, there are many other ERP products as well as enterprise solutions they acquired. From all these acquisitions, they've taken the best solutions. Okay, from all these acquisitions, they've taken the best solutions. Here, just I given the product names. After acquisition, the JD Edwards became Oracle JD Edwards, PeopleSoft now Oracle PeopleSoft, Siebel is now Oracle Siebel. Anyway, Oracle is, I mean, EBS suite is, or it's owned by Oracle, and Hyperion. So very famous, we know, in the market for budgeting, planning, and reporting purpose, we can use Hyperion. And Primavera also acquired by Oracle, which generally you can use for project planning purpose. Not only these products, many other products Oracle acquired, and many other technologies also they acquired, not only just products, technologies you can call as middleware technologies or cloud technologies. Okay, these are many products Oracle acquired. Now all those products you can see with the Oracle ownership. Okay, Oracle PeopleSoft, Oracle Siebel, Oracle Hyperion, Oracle Primavera. After acquiring all these products, what they taken is the, from their acquisitions and the products which are owned by that Oracle, they taken the best solutions. They selected, they picked. So PeopleSoft, from PeopleSoft they taken HCM. Okay, so here let me just take few points here. So what Oracle taken did is financials. They're taken from Oracle EBS. Procurement. Okay, procurement solution they're taken from JD Edwards. And HCM, human capital management. Which we call as HRMS payroll, right? Many products we have as a part of HCM. This HCM they taken from PeopleSoft. And they taken reporting CRM, okay, CRM solution from Siebel and Hyperion reporting, okay. The reporting solution they taken from Hyperion. Okay, not only these, there are many, but just to understand the concept, you don't need to talk about each and everything. Just these are the few examples which gives the better understanding how the Fusion application is built. Okay, so when you look at EBS, we have all the solutions. We have procurement, SCM, many other products we have. But what Oracle it is? From EBS, they taken financials. From JD Edwards, they taken a procurement solution. From PeopleSoft, HCM. And from Siebel CRM, from Hyperion reporting, from many other ERP products and other enterprise solutions, whatever Oracle acquired, they taken the best pieces and they built application called as Oracle Fusion Applications. Okay, this is the meaning of Oracle Fusion Applications. Okay, this is a very simple point. It's not like just from the one product they taken solution, from the different ERP products they take in the best area and they built on a ultimate application called as Fusion Applications. Now if any client is going to opt for this Fusion application implementation, so we have to think they are going to have a best solution for their financials, procurement, HCM and CRM and reporting. If they go with the only EBS, they can see the best solution only for finance. When you compare the procurement solution with JD Edwards, the EBS procurement solution may be a bit weak in terms of system, how it will be offering the solution to manage their business operations. The same way, when you compare your EBS HRMS with HCM, no doubt PeopleSoft is going to be the best. The same way CRM or reporting. So you take any example and compare with any specific ERP product, those are not going to be good enough compared to the respective EBS product of specialized area. Okay, so this is how just Oracle, how Oracle are taking the different areas of business solution from the different EBS, different ERP products, and they built application called as Oracle Fusion Applications. If you have any question on this point, you can raise, we can discuss, or else we can jump into the next point. Okay, just this is the meaning which you have to take when you talk about Fusion Applications. Any question here, please? Any question from anyone? Okay, so when we are going to work on Oracle Fusion Applications, we are not going to call it as EBS Financials, JD Edwards Procurement, PeopleSoft HCM, and Siebel CRM, and Hyperion Reporting. Okay, we are not going to call with a specific product related name. Now simply we'll be calling as Fusion Financials, and Fusion Procurement, and Fusion HCM, Fusion CRM, and it's just reporting. Okay, this is how just we can understand. For just for our understanding, I'm just taking the naming convention that way, from which product, which solution Oracle taken, and they build this product. Okay, when you look into Fusion Applications, this is how the naming convention we have, Fusion Financials. Okay. Okay, Fusion Procurement, Fusion HCM, Fusion CRM and Reporting. So any question on this, please? So not only these, there are many other products Oracle acquired, including the technologies, middleware technologies, and many other server technologies. Okay, many products they acquired. Just give me a second. Fine. So that's all about meaning of Oracle Fusion applications. Okay. So the other point here to discuss. So this is what just I mentioned in one slide. Oracle Fusion application means for the solutions from the different ERP products we are taking as a Fusion applications. The next point, we'll try to understand what is the meaning of on-premise and cloud. Okay. So we'll talk about this point, on-premise and cloud. One is say on-premise, other one is cloud. So what does it mean by on-premise? When you talk about the how we are going to manage the application, okay, based on that we can classify, okay, the server as, I mean, how you are going to manage the server, that can be classified into on-premise or cloud based maintenance. Okay, so when you talk about on-premise, what is the meaning of on-premise? Almost what are the EBS versions which you are implementing for the client, most of the, I mean, definitely you can see as on-premise only. That means in case of on-premise implementations, what we do is, so we'll take the license from the Oracle, right? In case of on-premise, so client will take the license from Oracle, and after taking the license for the product software, so client will buy the server infrastructure, and the application, the software will get installed in that server, and the server will be maintained by client only. And to install the server and to maintain that applications, will have a DBA and will have a, some technical team for network and other security aspects. Okay, we'll have a separate team. I can say the technical team. So they'll be managing the server, and we'll have a complete control on the server which is residing in our location. So that's how the on-premise will work. And when you talk about cloud, okay, when you talk about on-premise, what we are discussing, just on-premise means we'll have our own server. For that, there will be huge investment to buy the server infrastructure, and we should have a technical team to manage that server, to install the application or to take the backup of the application when we are running the system. And there will be a lot of cost is involved. And the what is the best out of on-premise means we'll have a great security for the data. So we are going to manage our server, so we don't need to worry about data security. So again, the server, complete entire product will be in our own our control. If you want to do any customizations, you can do it. And when you talk about cloud, what is the meaning of cloud? If you go with the cloud option, okay, on-premise means we'll take the license and we'll have our own server, and we'll have our team, technical team will be just taking care of the server. And we can have a complete control on the server, I mean to say on the product which we are which we deployed in the server. And whatever the customizations you want to do, you can do it. And there won't be any risk for the data which you are going to manage within that server environment. But when you talk about cloud, okay, so in case of on-premise, we have to take the license from Oracle. Okay, we have to take the license from Oracle. Where our applications are going to be reside. The applications will be residing, the software will be residing on the physical server, right? The physical server will be in our location. But when you talk about cloud, where our applications will be residing, the applications are not going to be residing in the physical server. The applications will be residing in the virtual server. Okay, with the cloud computing technology, what cloud computing company will do is, they'll be generating the virtual servers. The cloud computing company will generate the virtual servers. The what virtual servers will do is, where the virtual servers will be residing, the virtual servers will be residing as the internet as a source. So you don't need to just depend on physical server to maintain your applications. The actual server, the actual physical servers will be managed by Oracle Cloud Computing Company or Oracle Cloud or any other cloud computing company. And based on that physical servers, what the company is owning, they can generate the virtual servers. The virtual servers will be residing in the internet. That means when you compare with on-premise, okay, on-premise cloud with on-premise, in case of on-premise, we'll have a physical server. In case of cloud, there won't be any physical server. The physical server we cannot see in cloud case. Here we'll be having virtual server. That is the first difference. And where on-premise server will be located, that will be residing in our location. But when you talk about cloud, the virtual servers will be residing in the internet as a source. Okay, that will be part of internet. You don't find in specific location. And other point is, when you talk about on-premise solution, you have to buy the license. You have to buy the license for the product. But if you go with the cloud offering from Oracle, you don't need to buy the license from Oracle. Just you have to take the subscription. You have to take the subscription. You are not going to have a complete rights on the product which you are going to use. We'll talk on that more detail level. And in case of on-premise, you can do the customizations, whatever you want to do. But in case of cloud, there will be some limitations. Again, customizations are possible. That depends on which option you are choosing from Oracle. Okay, so these are the points. And one more important point is, so in case of on-premise, you have to buy the server infrastructure and you have to install. But in case of cloud, you don't need to buy any server infrastructure, and the complete solution will be offered by Oracle only. Just will be using and will be paying. And another point to understand here is, in case of on-premise, okay, so you'll have a complete control on the server, what are the software you are taking the license. But in case of cloud, that depends on which model of option you are choosing. That points anyway, we are going to discuss on that. So here, just simple point I'm trying to say, what is the simple difference between on-premise and cloud? Normally, that EBS, okay, the EBS applications we are running on on-premise only. And here Fusion applications, most of the Fusion applications, if you see in the market, the clients are running on cloud. Not only this, best example for cloud is we have a Salesforce. Okay, there are many other Workday, and there are many other products which are running on the cloud base. So on-premise and cloud. Just these are the simple points to understand. If you have any questions on this, please.
Hi, Lakshman.
Yep.
What about the safety? Actually, on premises, we have to store ourselves within our virtual machine. But in the cloud, is we have to save the data at Oracle side, right?
Correct. On premise means yes, we have our physical server, and we'll have our own team, and they'll take care of the data security. Yes. When you talk about cloud, yes, in case of cloud, we are not going to have a physical server, whatever the client information, okay, very sensitive information or whatever you call, that information will be stored in the Oracle servers. And when you talk about data security, yes, they are taking safety measures, like how they can secure the client data, that all Oracle is taking care of that. Because of that reason only, many of bank clients also started using the cloud application. So client no need to worry about data security. Okay, Oracle is make sure that you'll have enough security for the data which is going to be there as a part of their servers. Okay, so that's the reason most of the clients are showing interest to go with the cloud. Okay, so yes, there is one view where what about data security for their company data, if they are going to trust some cloud computing company and they are going to start using the services. In case of Oracle, they are taking all the security measures, and they are taking care of the complete data. They'll make sure that there won't be any risk for the data which is going to be stored in the Oracle servers.
Hi Lakshman, I have one question.
Yep.
It's cloud and on-premise. Are there any difference in the setups or the way the front end looks, the forms and everything, or is just the data hosting that's different?
Just hosting only. The application where we are going to host the application. Yes, when you say application, definitely application means we use application for hosting the data only. But generally, let's call it as application or product.
Okay.
That's it. No difference. No difference. Okay. There will be few differences that we are going to talk about. But in setup point of view, no. When you go with on-premise, you'll have a full permissions. But when you go with the cloud, based on which option you are choosing. Within the cloud, we have a different options. Based on our requirement, you can choose. That makes slight difference that we are going to talk about.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. So any other questions? Here only the simple point is, okay, now let me talk about this. I'll call it as, I'll name it as Oracle Fusion Applications. Or instead of calling as applications, let's go with the specification as financial, Oracle Fusion Financials. Okay, and Oracle Fusion. Oracle Cloud Financials or Oracle Cloud Fusion Financials. So what is the difference between these two? It's very simple. So the product wise, we have a product from Oracle, Oracle Fusion Applications. The Fusion Applications we are going to run on the on-premise server that we call as Oracle Fusion Applications. The same Fusion Applications if you are going to use with a cloud model, that you simply you can call as Oracle Cloud Financials or Oracle Cloud Fusion Financials. So this is what we have to understand. There is no much difference between the Oracle Fusion Financials and Oracle Cloud Fusion Financials. So only the meaning you have to take from here is, so where you are running that applications, where you deployed in on-premise server or cloud server, virtual server. You are running, you are maintaining these applications on-premise server or, I mean to say physical server or virtual server. Based on that, you can give the name for that, whether that is Oracle Fusion Applications or Oracle Cloud Financials or Oracle Cloud Fusion Financials. So this is a simple point we have to understand. So based on the deployment only. Okay. So any other questions here, please?
Hey, Lakshman,
Yeah,
I got a question to Sachin. When you say cloud, that means we are sharing our data, customers sharing their data with Oracle and they are being hosted in the virtual server, right? That's what you're saying. So is there any limitation as far as the volume of the data is concerned? For example, some customer might have huge volume of data. So are there any limitations or does Oracle charge differently based on the volume of your data?
No. There is no subscription based on the volume of data. Till today, the subscription works based on the number of users.
Okay. So it doesn't matter how many transactions any customers would be having.
No.
Some customers would be different than other one, right?
No. Yes, that's true. But that kind of subscription is not there so far. Okay. So only the subscription here, it's like user-based subscription only, not transactional-based subscription.
Okay.
Yeah.
Got it.
Yeah. Okay. Any other questions?
Next one, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. So my question is, when you have your on-premise, typically we are responsible for patching and upgrading. During cloud, in cloud installations, who is responsible? Is Oracle doing that or are they going to charge it to the customer or the client or how do they do the patching and upgrading for anything?
That I'll be covering in the same session and maybe the next point. But anyway, let me answer as a quick for your quick question. See, in case of cloud, that will be done by Oracle. That's a simple point. I'm going to just give you. I mean, I'm going to run through you one slide which gives the good information about on-premise and cloud. What we will do here in on-premise, in case of cloud, how it makes the difference. What Oracle will do and what we no need to do, what are the advantages and the disadvantages, these points will come across. But to answer to your question, yes, that all will be done. But in case of on-premise, we'll take the responsibility. If any patch Oracle is suggesting, yes, we'll be applying, we should have a DBA to apply the patch. In case of cloud, the patch application will be done by cloud team. We no need to have a DBA. And in case of upgrade, if you want to upgrade from older version to current version or latest version, in case of on-premise, we should deploy a team to do the upgrade activity. But in case of cloud, so here again two options we have. One is Oracle will do. Other option is we should have a resource who will be helping for that upgrade. That points we'll discuss in which case how it works. Okay, but just to make it very simple, upgrades and patching will be done by Oracle only in case of cloud. But we'll get into more detailed information. We'll see that. Any other questions on these two points, please? Okay, fine. Since no questions, I will just move to other slide. So this is what just I mentioned here. On-premise means we'll be having server in our location, and in case of cloud, the servers will be residing in the internet. They kept as symbolically in the cloud environment. Means these are just virtual. Okay, the virtual servers will be residing as internet as a source. If just from anywhere, like even now this cloud. If you are using that cloud application, if you are a cloud customer for Oracle, now you can access to your instance from your mobile device also. That's how we have a option now. So just you should get connected to internet, then you'll be able to work on the application. Fine. And other points here, we'll go more detail level between cloud and on-premise. What are the differences? So first we'll look into on-premise applications. So in case of on-premise application, what points we have to consider? See here, just I given few points to understand. So CapEx, upfront investment, that means we have to invest a lot for server infrastructure, and customer owned upgrades and patching. So in case of on-premise, so we have to take the responsibility of doing the upgrades and patch applications. And we should depend on some data centers. Okay, there could be some disasters takes place. Okay, and the costly customizations created and created for customizations also. It's like we have to invest a lot and all compared to cloud customizations. This on-premise customizations are very costly, and annual support cost where just will be paying to Oracle. And these are the few points we have to understand. Other one is other important point to understand is outdated software resulting in missed business benefits. Means here what happens, you know, like yes, we have to upgrade. We have to upgrade whenever we want to go with the latest version. But if you are not going to upgrade time to time, what happens? The business will be missing the benefits which comes with the new version of the product. So these are the few points to understand when you are on on-premise environment. If you move to just this cloud platform, so these are the few points you can consider how it works. So you are not going to take any license for the product. It works as a rent based. Okay, rent a flexible service, pay as you grow. So how many users you require a subscription, you can take the subscription on the rent base. You are not going to take any license for the product. Okay, another point here is the standard security and access anywhere, whenever. Just it's all about Oracle will take care of the complete security for the subscription, what you taken, for which instance you have access. The security and all will, everything will be taken care by Oracle, but from anywhere you can connect as you require. Another important point is no upgrades, okay, but latest functionality is available. And regular releases. No upgrades in the sense, what happens is if you go with the Fusion cloud applications, Oracle will take care of auto upgrade. Okay, Oracle will take care of auto upgrade. So if you, since this is a cloud, everything will be controlled by Oracle. So if tomorrow Oracle is going to come up with a new release, if you are running on the latest, whatever the version, current version we have in the market. So whenever Oracle come up with a new release, automatically your environment will get upgraded. You don't need to do as a separate activity, that will be taken care by Oracle only. So this is how it makes the difference compared to on-premise environment. Okay, on-premise environment, again that here we have a like a patching and all will be done by on-premise team only, like client team. But in case of cloud, the patches and upgrades, everything will be done by cloud team. Okay, the cloud support only will take care of all the patches and upgrade activities. So if you are running on the Fusion version called as release 10, and now we have release 11 in the market. If the client who is on release 10, if they want to upgrade to release 11, just we have to inform to Oracle, and they'll be asking for the schedule, what time they can do the upgrade activity. As a client, we can inform to the Oracle, then they'll complete it. Okay. Again, there are some limitations in which scenario that can be possible, in which case that is not possible. Within the cloud also, we have a different options that we, anyway, we are going to talk on that. Any questions based on this, please?
Lakshman, two questions actually. First one, on the cloud side, you mentioned rent a flexible service, pay as you grow. So you said that is based on number of users. Does cloud comes with all the offerings, or you can choose one of the offerings and based on that the rates will be decided?
Yes.
For example, you can make.
Yeah, I got your point. So I mean the subscription offering base, basically that the product families are. Primary business process here we are calling as offering. Financials we call as offering.
Right.
So the subscription offering base. Okay.
Okay.
So it's not for everything. It's not for all the products. Okay. The subscription financials. Okay. We need, say, for example, we have 50 users. So you have to take the subscription for financials, 50 users. Procurement, say you have 10 users. For 10 users, for procurement, you have to take separately. Okay. This is how it works.
Okay.
Yeah. The solution specific subscriptions.
Yeah, got it. Yeah, got it. Thank you. And other question is, when you mentioned upgrade, so Oracle will inform you that and they will find out what is the good window for upgrade. So do we get any separate instance as such as well in case of cloud to do the assessment? Is there any impact for this upgrade? For example, if you're going from 9 to 10, we need to do some impact analysis, right? Whether it will impact the data.
No. We don't need to do that. That everything will taken care by Oracle. If everything is going to work fine, then only Oracle is going to do the upgrade activity for us. We don't need to do anything from our end, because we are not going to take any responsibility. Okay, Oracle will take care of, because, I mean, we will be in that mode of cloud. I'll talk on that. More detail level. Now we are talking about just cloud applications. Within that, we have a different models. When I talk about that, maybe it will be more clear. But to answer to your question, we don't need to do any kind of analysis on that, which will impact, which won't impact.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep. Any other questions here? Okay, we'll move on to next point. Here, see, we are talking about cloud applications. When you talk about cloud applications, there are the three options are available within the cloud, which you are calling as cloud services or cloud deployment model or adoptions. Okay, so fine. So we decided to go with the cloud. So we don't want to buy a server infrastructure. We don't want to take the license for a product. We don't want to have a technical team who will install and who will be managing everything. And whenever new release comes into the market, we are not interested to go with our own upgrade activity, and we don't want to do the patches, etc., etc. We are not at all interested to take this sort of risk. So we decided to go with the cloud services. Okay, we want to take the product with a subscription based user for each user, how much subscribe there will be, separate fees, and we are ready to go with that. Now the question is, in the cloud services, which service we have to select? We have three options here. One is SaaS, second one is PaaS, third one is IaaS. Okay, SaaS, PaaS, IaaS. What is the meaning of this SaaS, PaaS and IaaS? We'll see that. Okay, so cloud services. Let's say adoptions. Or say models. Okay, anything you can call. So what we have, the first one is SaaS. SaaS stands for service as a software. Software as a service. SaaS stands for software as a service. And when you talk about PaaS, PaaS stands for platform as a service. The third adoption or model is IaaS. IaaS stands for Infrastructure as a Service. Okay, these are the three different services or models or adoptions are available from Oracle. So what is the difference between these three? So to make it very simple, if you choose SaaS model, okay, if you choose SaaS model as a part of cloud, so you are going with the cloud option, within that you are choosing SaaS. So in that case, customizations are not possible. Or else let me say less customizations. No, let me write it. We'll talk on that. I'll explain. I'll say no customizations. No auto upgrades. Okay, this is the key points we have to understand when you talk about SaaS. If you choose SaaS option from Oracle as a part of cloud solutions, cloud services, so within the SaaS environment, you cannot do any customizations. You can do some personalizations. Say, for example, you want to develop one function in payables or receivables. So in the SaaS model, Oracle is not going to give you the option to develop any functionality. If you want to create our own report, some custom report, you can do that. That is a part of reports. But functionality related features, you cannot customize in case of SaaS. The other option is, okay, sorry, this is auto upgrade is possible. Here we are talking about SaaS, right? So no customizations, but the benefit here is, if Oracle is going to come up with a new release, the auto upgrade is possible. You can upgrade from current version to latest version. That is a possible. In case of PaaS, here you can do the customizations, but no auto upgrade. Here also same, but there is slight difference. We'll see that anyway. So these are the points you have to understand. If you choose, your client is going to choose cloud as a SaaS model. So in the SaaS model, you cannot do any customizations. What you can do, you can create the custom reports, but not custom functionality. Okay. And since you are not doing any customizations related to application functionality, when Oracle comes up with the new release, the current from, you can easily like, or you can upgrade from current to latest version. In case of PaaS model, platform as a service, Oracle will provide the platform which allows you to do the customization as per your business requirements. But since you are doing the customizations, simply that environment cannot be upgraded to the latest version. If you want to, you know, like in the on-premise also, you'll do your own customizations and all. When we are upgrading to the next version, you have to take care of all the customizations. Which customizations are invited by latest current version? Which customizations are cannot be accessed by latest version? Which points you have to consider after doing the upgrade? What changes you have to do? Everything you have to consider. In the same way, in the PaaS model also, Oracle is going to provide the platform where you can do customizations as per your business requirement. Since you are going to have a customizations in that product environment, it's not possible to convert that environment to, I mean, that cannot be upgraded automatically with the help of Oracle. And in case of IaaS also, infrastructure as a service, here also like Oracle will give the platform to do the customization. Apart from that, Oracle will give option to choose the infrastructure also, that we'll talk on that. Here also no upgrade possible. These are the primary key points we have to understand. If there is a client who are looking for, whose business require huge customization, then only the option they can choose is PaaS model. Now in the market, if you see, so more than 90% of clients are choosing SaaS model only. The reason is the auto upgrade is possible. And negative point, the customizations are not possible if they go with the SaaS model. But still their expectation is, if the so-and-so function or feature is not available in the current version, that will just come out in the next release. That's how they are planning and they are moving with the SaaS model. Okay, that's just, these are the very simple points to discuss. If you have any specific questions on these points, you can raise. Any questions on these?
Yep. If a client is heavy on customization, okay, and he chooses PaaS, so does the client need to have its core team for upgrade, like a DBA and stuff?
No, DBA not required. So Oracle will help for the custom. Oracle will help for the auto upgrade, but you should have a team to look after which customization. They have to do the analysis. They have to do the analysis in this current version. Okay, this is how the functionality works. In this latest version, oh, this is how it works. Is there any difference? So they have to make a note. See here, when we are doing in 11.8 to release 12 upgrades and all, what points will be focusing related to customizations. Those we have to make a note. After completing the upgrade and all, we have to just go and do the required changes. This and all we have to take care of. See, so you have a like a PaaS model. Oracle will do auto upgrade. Oracle can do it. Oracle will do auto upgrade. But what are the customizations you did, all will miss. Those won't be working in the latest environment. So that is the reason you should have a team who will take care of that changes, updating, and wherever required. So that is the reason Oracle is not going to do auto upgrade. They can do it. After doing, there is no guarantee it will be working as is how it was working in the previous version.
Okay.
So Oracle will do the customization. Okay. But only the thing is, it's not auto upgrade. Once you... Why we are calling as auto upgrade means, in case of SaaS, once I'm informing to Oracle saying that please do auto upgrade today. Okay, I give in the time today, just today, like when users are not going to work on the server, they'll do it. It's say today it's scheduled evening time. Okay, say for example 10 p.m. IST, it's scheduled. By tomorrow morning, I may hear the news from Oracle saying that upgrade activity we completed. Now blindly we can inform to the users, you can start using the application. I no need to go and check anything. Okay. Because no customizations in that environment, nothing is going to get disturbed. Everything asked is standard product.
But how about the reports? The reports, can we customize reports in case of SaaS?
SaaS, yes, it will be moved as is. We don't need to worry about it.
Okay.
It will move somewhere, some functionality changes that will reflect your report. In that case, you can go to BI reports and all. You can change that respective parameter and all. It's not a great challenge. See, when you say report, it's not going to touch the functionality, right? It is going to be separate. Right. So just to fetch the data and to display based on the availability, right? So it doesn't disturb the flow or functionalities. That is the reason that we don't need to worry about it. Even you have a custom reports, the auto upgrade will support for that. If any changes you have to do, you can do it.
So in what cases will client go for IaaS?
Yeah. So here I'll show you the slide and we'll talk about that. See here, in case of SaaS model, you will get access to only application to use it. You'll get access to application to use it. And in case of PaaS model, you will get access to application to use. At the same time, you will get a option to do some customizations. You will get an environment, application customization environment also you'll get. The custom customizations will support. Here, in case of PaaS, just you'll get access to application to use. Here, in PaaS model, you'll get access to application to use as well as to do the some customizations. But in case of IaaS, you'll get access to use applications. You'll have, in addition to that, you'll have access to do the some customizations. Apart from that, you will have a access to database also. Okay, I'll have a simple slide here which will talks about what is the difference between these three. Let me take you through that. Okay, but these three options, we have SaaS, PaaS and IaaS. You see the slide. So SaaS, PaaS and IaaS. See here. So in case of SaaS, everything will be managed by vendor. Here vendor is nothing but Oracle in our case. So application, security, database, operating system, okay, virtualization, server, storage, network, data center, everything will be managed by Oracle only. But in case of PaaS, managed by us. Here, managed by us is nothing but here, we can manage the applications, whatever you want to customize. The customized applications you can manage, that is the meaning of that. Okay, and anyway, we'll have a full rights to the applications what we are going to get from Oracle as a subscription. Okay, so we'll have a control. We can manage the applications, means we can do some sort of customization. That is the meaning of managed by us. Only applications, okay, they'll give the platform where you can do the customization as per business requirement. Rest of everything, you cannot have any control on this. The security or database, operating system, virtualization, servers, storage, network, data centers, all can be, all will be managed by vendor only. Just they'll give option to us, privilege to us in case of PaaS model to go and do some customization, which is related to applications. Here there is no access for anything. Just you can use the applications. And in case of IaaS, so we can manage applications as well as application related security and database. The rest will be managed by Oracle only. These three can be managed by us. Okay. There's a very big clients may go with IaaS, but so very small clients who don't need any customization, they can go with the SaaS, and mid-sized clients can go with the PaaS, where they need some minimum customizations, and they want to come up with a lot of security related requirements and database maintenance and all, where they can just increase large volume of the data, and the different reasons they may go with this IaaS model. Okay, so this is a simple.
Lakshman.
Yep.
Lakshman, a question here. When we are talking about SaaS, PaaS, and IaaS, so like in an enterprise world where we are integrating with multiple hundreds of other applications, so which model is best suits for the for keeping the integrations in mind?
So see, integrations are supported by these three models. Okay. Integrations are supported by three models, no doubt, because we have a middleware. So you go with the SaaS or PaaS, IaaS, you can integrate. You can integrate with other applications, and you can bring the data into this application, or you can move the data from this any one of the environment to other applications. That is possible in three cases. Okay, only we are talking about customizations. So primary here, key point we are highlighting is customization, where it is possible, where it is not possible. And other point here is, in case of SaaS, yes, you can use that standard product how it is available. Okay, I'm not talking about reports. Report, anyway, it can be customized. That we are not considering as a customizations. Here you can use the application as is. Here you can change and you can use. Here you can change and use as well as you will have access to database. In case of SaaS and SaaS model, okay, SaaS model and PaaS model, you cannot have a full access to database. Say now in EBS, you can connect the database to Toad. But if you go with the SaaS and PaaS, you cannot connect the database to Toad to fetch the data and all. Only the option is through BI reporting. When you are developing the reports by using the BI functionality, you can go and query the data and you can view the data. That's how it works. Here in SaaS or PaaS model, the same you'll be doing. You don't have a complete privileges where you can directly connect to database, you can fetch the data and you can see. Okay, I request you all, seems to somebody is unmuted. I can hear some noise. Okay, please check from your end and mute if you are not going to ask any question. Okay, please, thank you. So this is what, in case of IaaS, okay, you'll have a database access also. You can just connect to any front-end tool. From there, you can fetch the data and you can just look into that. That's how it works. In SaaS model, yeah, please go ahead.
You also mentioned all the license cost and the are based on the number of users and not based on the storage.
Yes.
But in a complex enterprise world, if we are having few terabytes of data, will it be the same, or is there a separate charge for storage and the application fee? How is that exactly?
When we are taking the license, Oracle is not talking about volume of the data. That's what I am trying to say. So only they are talking about subscription. How many users, that's all. If such kind of concern we have, just we can talk to Oracle. But when you look into, when you are dealing with Oracle, there is no term they are mentioning somewhere. Only this volume. Say if I say I need 100 users, they are talking about users only. They are not talking about this is a volume of data can be supported for in case of 10 users or for each user this much. That term we don't see anywhere. Okay.
Hi, Lakshman.
Yep.
Hello,
yeah,
please
please.
manage.
Yeah, yeah, please.
Yeah, how database differs from EBS to Fusion? Or still we use the same database or?
Yeah, here, yeah, when I talk about database, we have same database, Oracle database, the backend. And on top of it, we have additional another database also for reporting purpose, which we call as SBase, Hyperion SBase. That is another database we have, which is a multi-dimensional database. You know, in Oracle database, the total data will be stored in the form of tables, within the tables and the columns. But in SBase, the data will be stored in the multi-dimensional cubes. When we are working on reports, I'll explain that. But to answer to your question, this is a point. Along with Oracle database, database remains same as how it was there in EBS. But in addition to that, we have one more database called as SBase database, purely which will support for reporting requirements. Reporting purpose, I can say, simple.
Okay. So in all these models, the database will be maintained by us.
No.
Only in the PaaS we'll be maintaining the database, yeah?
No, no, no. In SaaS and PaaS by Oracle only in case of IaaS. You can see in this slide.
Yeah, right? Yeah, okay.
Okay, in IaaS only we'll have a full rights controls on the database. In other cases,
okay.
Now here no database access, here also no database access, here no customizations, here we can do the customization. But here,
okay.
The customization, you can look after the security and the database access also. In these two cases, you cannot connect the database connection with third party tools, any other tool. Only the option is within the web page itself, you'll have a framework. It's where you can query the data and you can see that too. They give an option to develop the BA reports as per our requirement. That we can take as advantage to query the data and all. Otherwise, there is no separate provision Oracle is giving. Here, you can use this option to connect to database and to query the data. That's how it works.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, thanks. Any other questions on this?
Lakshman, so the point you're trying to make is, let's say, have a pure software which is offered by the Oracle on SaaS, and let's say if you have a custom application built, then you can actually go for a IaaS where you can actually host the complete application.
No, no, no. To build the custom application, you don't need to go to IaaS. PaaS is enough.
Okay. Okay, because database is available. Let's in case, like, you know, you have to go for a GIS database or something which is not really by the Oracle product, then you have to go for IaaS, and then you can very well orchestrate, integrate
exactly.
with all the other ways, right?
You can choose your infrastructure. You'll have an option to choose infrastructure. That is the meaning of IaaS, infrastructure as a service. So you will be having option for choosing the infrastructure and having complete control on that.
Right. Okay. Got it. Thanks.
Yeah, thanks. So any questions on this?
Lakshman, at any point of time, you can switch from SaaS to PaaS and IaaS?
Yeah, it's a good question. Yes, possible.
Yeah, okay. So we can't switch from PaaS to SaaS, right? So that is vice versa.
No, no, no. When you are at SaaS, means it's a standard. In case of PaaS, you will do some changes that you cannot take it as a standard. Of course, certain stage you can freeze it, but still you cannot move from PaaS to SaaS or IaaS to PaaS.
Yeah, thanks.
As a solution, which you expect from Oracle, but see, you may go with the PaaS and you may do some customization. You may start using in future. You are going to roll back the customization which you did. In that case, you may move back to SaaS to utilize, to get a benefit of SaaS adoption. In that way it works, but in the SaaS model, if you are going to have many customizations, by keeping all the customizations are active, you cannot come back to SaaS. It won't work in that way. Yep.
Okay.
Pull back and all, yes, you can come back to SaaS.
Okay.
Yep. Fine. Any other questions? Okay. Fine. These are the few points we have to understand when you talk about the cloud applications. So now you can see most of the clients are using more than 90%. I can say more than 95%. So that's my experience. So that's all about SaaS. And the same I just mentioned over there, what is a Fusion Financials or cloud? If your financials, Fusion Financials are going to be part of your on-premise server that we call as Oracle Fusion Financial Applications, whatever the Fusion applications you take in the subscription from Oracle, if those are going to be part of virtual machines, then those you can call as Oracle Fusion Cloud Financial Applications. There is no difference, as there was some question like when you are working on the application, you don't see any difference. In case of on-premise, you'll have a complete privileges to play with the application. In case of cloud, so there will be certain restrictions, but the certain restrictions are not going to disturb our work, what we are going to do as a consultant in terms of configuration or process. Okay, so beyond that, there'll be some limitation, but as a functional consultant, what setups we have to do and what process we have to test or what we have to present to the client, there you don't see any issue with that. So other point here is,
out of these three models, which one is the most popular?
The first one, SaaS only. SaaS.
Which one is the most popular model?
SaaS only. Because even in a past, the customizations are possible. The negative point what clients are looking at is the auto upgrade is not possible. That again, that will become challenge for them. Okay, they'll just miss the new features what Oracle is going to release from version to version. So that is the reason most of the clients are using SaaS only.
Okay, if we are upgrading to SaaS and in order like leveraging the middleware for all the integrations, so will it be taken care by the Oracle, or is it something that client has to do?
Okay, think always upgrade means it happens to your application. Okay, middleware is a completely separate part from application. Now I'm going to talk about the same application architecture. Then we can see the point. It's a middleware, it's again separate space. Okay, so if you upgrade your application related, everything will get upgraded. And middleware part, once you upgrade, see middleware, it's just connectivity. So you want to connect from AP, you want to pass some data to some third party systems. So from AP, you'll be just using the middleware as an agent to pass the information from our accounts payables to some third party system. That's how it works. So we don't need to consider middleware in case of upgrades. Okay. The technical upgrades can take place, but those won't impact the integrations which we build through middleware. Basically, we'll be using the SOVA, service oriented architecture, for this kind of integrations. Okay. Fine. If that is not you are looking for, just you can raise your question, please. What exactly you are trying to understand? The same or something else, please.
When we go for the implementation, who will do that part? That's what I'm trying to understand.
Okay, good. Okay, you are talking about third party integrations we will do, right?
Yes.
Yeah. We should have a SOVA consultant. Okay.
Is it client responsibility, or will it be covered as part of the contract with Oracle?
No. It's a client responsibility.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's what I'm trying to.
Yeah. So that's a client responsibility, because that is our business requirement. So that's our business requirement. Okay. So when you're doing that, if you need any support, Oracle will help, since there is some support team. Only that is a point you have to consider. Rest should be done by us only. When you talk about a patch, they will do it. When you talk about upgrade, they'll do it. But when you talk about integration, we should do it. If any support required, Oracle will help us on that. Okay. So any other questions, please? Okay, now we'll talk about Fusion architecture. So when I talk about Fusion architecture, when I talk about first EBS, we have just applications, right? And we have a database. So in the when you talk about applications, so let me call it as EBS applications databases, Oracle database. So here applications is just example GL, AP, ER, CM, FA, so on many other applications. The same way database, Oracle database we have. So we'll just, I will do the required setups and we'll start entering the data that directly that particular application will get connected to the database with respect to schema. Data will get stored within that. If you want to do some integrations and all, what we do, directly we'll connect with the application. We know in EBS, if I want to do any other application with the other application, if I want to integrate any third party application with the AP, directly we'll integrate with the AP only. There is no other technique or technology which we'll be using to integrate third party application with this accounts payable application through other interfaces. Now directly we'll integrate, we'll build a sub interface that will be connected. Say for example, if I want to load the open invoice, I want to import it to AP. We'll directly build a sub interface. The sub interface will connect with the standard open interface called as payables AP open, payables open invoice interface. That's how the integration will take place. But in the Fusion, it won't work in this way. The Fusion, what happens is, when you talk about Fusion architecture, we have a Fusion applications. Okay. And we have a Fusion middleware. And we have a Fusion databases. Okay. So this is the arc structure we have. On the top, we'll have applications. And bottom, you have a databases. In between, we have a middleware. So whatever you do, whatever you do within the applications, okay, those will be controlled by. So whatever you do as a part of applications, those all will be controlled by middleware. And the total security will be built for the application on which application you are going to work and all the security and all, everything will be enforced by middleware only. Here you can set up what kind of control you require when you are working on the application. Or when you are going to integrate any application with a third party application, the integration will take place through middleware only. There is no direct integration how we do in EBS. In EBS AP, you may do with XYZ expense system, or you may do GL integration with ABC HRMS system. But in case of Fusion, any integration you do that has to be, that you should do through middleware only. We have a different components as a part of middleware. Through that only we'll be doing. We'll talk on that few points. Then if you have any question, we can discuss. So when you talk about Fusion applications, yes, as we know, like Fusion GL, AP, AR, CM, FA, and Fusion tax, nothing but e-business tax, Fusion expense, nothing but i-expense. So and there are many other applications like purchasing, okay, OEM, all the applications we have. So when you talk about Fusion middleware, what we have as a part of Fusion middleware. So here we have OEM, or you can call as IDM, APM, BPM, OEM, UCM, not OEM, UCM, Universal Content Management. So these are different middleware components, and we have SOA, okay, and we have BPL. There are many other components as a part of middleware. And when you talk about Fusion databases, we have Oracle database, and we have Sbase database. Okay, so this is how you can find the middleware. Okay, so applications, we don't need to talk on this much. Okay, just some naming conventions you may see as it's slightly changed. In EBS, what we call as EBT, e-business tax, here you call as Fusion tax. And Fusion expense, nothing but i-expense as per EBS. And just we have to understand these points. In the Fusion middleware, these are the, we call as middleware components. Okay, what is the meaning of OIM? OIM stands for Oracle Identity Manager. The Oracle Identity Manager only you can call as IDM also. Both are same. IDM stands for Identity Manager. So what is the use of OM or IDM? In EBS, we have a system administrator responsibility. Okay, with the system administrator responsibility, what we can do is we can create the users. Okay. We can create the users and we can assign the responsibility to the users and we can set the passwords and password related policies, and we can create the custom menus, right? And custom request groups, all activities we can do from the system administrator, equal to the system administrator we have OIM or IDM. This is equal to sysadmin, but when you are working on this, you can understand more detail level up to what level it is equal to sysadmin. But for now, you can just, you can compare and you can understand. So in sysadmin, EBS, we have a sysadmin equal to that in Fusion applications, we have OIM or IDM. Generally, we call as IDM. Okay, so even that is a, you can use OIM, but generally we call as IDM. So APM. Okay, APM stands for Authorization Policy Manager. Okay, so in EBS, when you talk about the menus for each application, we have a seeded menus. We have a seeded menus. In Fusion, we don't have any concept called as menus. The menus generally we call as a roles. So for each application, if I take example payables, for payables Oracle is delivering some list of roles. And in the same way for GL, AP, AR, CM, FA, for each and every application Fusion, Oracle is giving some seeded roles. So for each and every application, what are the roles Oracle is delivering? Those roles can be managed with the help of role templates. So for each application, how many seeded menus, seeded roles we have, those all can be managed within the APM. Okay, within the APM, you can have module specific role templates. Within this, we'll be having the role template. Within the template, the module specific roles can be managed. With the help of these templates only, the actual roles will be created, which you can assign to the user. That points we have to get into the application, then only we can talk on that more. But simple point you can understand here. So by using the IDM, you can create the users and you can assign the here we call as roles. In EBS we call as responsibilities, here we call as roles. In IDM we can create the users and we can assign the required roles to the user, but all the roles can be managed within the APM only with the help of role templates. And even if you create the custom roles also, like in EBS we create menus, custom menus. In the same way, there we are creating the menus, here we are creating the roles. Here I am talking about role is equal to menu, role is equal to responsibility. Again, within the role we have a different type of role, so that's what we have to understand. Anyway, we'll see, you may see those points in the next session. Okay, so here you may not get exact understanding when you talk about this point, but just take as a point here. By using APM, you can maintain the role templates. Here you can manage the role template for each and every application. Oracle is delivering certain roles. Those can be managed here. If you are going to create the custom roles also, those custom roles also you have to take into the role template. Then only system will be creating the data role. This point may not be clear for you, so you just will understand in the next session. So that is the use of APM. And we have a BPM, business process management. Okay, business process management, it's nothing but as per EBS, AME, approval management engine. Okay, so if you want to set up any approvals related to purchasing, or if you want to set the approvals for invoicing or any other approvals, you can set from AME and EBS. Now that same application you can see as a BPM here, business process management, which is very friendly when you go and do the setups. The simple rules you can define. You don't need to go with such a, I mean, complex process which you follow in EBS. Will assign the row, I mean, so and so grants to the user, and the automatic system will assign so and so responsibilities. You have to go to different responsibility, from there you can set up, etc. All these setups you don't need to do it in Fusion. They're simplified, and it's you can set up roles however you, I mean, you can set up rules however you require as per your business requirement. It's a very simple solution. Okay, anyway, we'll be working on this BPM also. We'll be setting the approvals for invoice approvals, purchase order approvals, and journal approvals. All will be setting, okay, for purchasing AP and GL. For these three applications, we'll be working on this BPM so that we can understand how this works and how roles can be defined, how these are simple when you compare with EBS. So this is also part of middleware only. The same way we have a UCM, other component as a part of middleware. It's nothing but universal content management. Okay, this UCM can be used for data imports and exports. Okay, if you want to load the data into our Fusion application, the data will be loaded through UCM only. If you remember data conversion concept, okay, in EBS, if you want to do the data conversion or data migration, what technical people do is technical people will build a staging tables. Okay, they'll just get all the data, they'll convert into respective format, flat files or CSV. The data, they'll be, by writing a lot of coding, they'll be extracting the data from the templates. Okay, and that they'll be loading into staging tables. There they'll write a lot of validations. From there, they'll move the data into interface tables. From there, they will import the data into base table. This is the process we'll follow. In that process, what technical people are doing, they are building the staging tables. Okay, staging tables equal to staging tables. We have a standard solution from Oracle. By using this UCM, Universal Content Management, any data you can load into this. Okay, there are predefined validations Oracle defined. By just passing those all the validation, the data can be moved into targeted based interface and interface to base tables. We'll be working on that. In Fusion, what happens, you know, like the what I can say is open transactions and master data, all you can load into the system without any technical support. Okay, we have a FBDA templates, file based data import templates. We'll collect the data into that. With a single click, we can convert the entire data into CSV format. Okay, the files we can load into UCM by submitting one program. You can populate the data in interface. By submitting another job or program, we can import the data into base tables. If you want to load the supplier's data, say it's a 5 minutes job. If you have all the data which is properly client provided, just within 5 minutes, you can load all the data into, you know, base tables of the respective data. So those are all we can do through UCM only, Universal Content Management. And the same way you have SOVA, service oriented architecture. Basically, the service oriented architecture we can use for data integrations. I mean, third party integrations only. Within that, we have a web service and connectors. Okay, the different services are available in SOA, service oriented architecture. So any third party integrations we have to do, that you have to do through middleware only. In the middleware, we have one component called as SOVA. And if you want to do any kind of BPM, business process management approvals, if you want to build your own, see, you know, like in EBS, we can create our own workflows. The same way here, the same solution you can see as a BPM. The BPM, if you want to create your own custom workflows and all with the help of BPL language. This is a BPL, stands for Business Process Execution Language. This can be used with the SOA and in the middleware, whatever the just communication you want to build between the different components or applications. You can use this language. By using this language, you can build a separate BPM workflow, or else here you can use that BPL to write some execution language when SOA is going to help to connect a different application to pass information as a inbound or outbound. So this is how you can use the middleware. The finally, we have a Fusion databases. Okay, so Oracle database we use for transaction data, and SBase database will use for to store the balances, account balance related data, which can be used for reporting purpose. Which reporting? Hyperion reporting. Now the Hyperion reporting we have as a part of Fusion application as the inbuilt solution. In the GL, we use FSG, financial financial report generator. Now in Fusion, you don't see that. In that place, they given Hyperion financial reporting, FRS we call, financial reporting studio. Okay, so if when you are working on that, the data system will be fetching from here only. Before that, whatever the data you store in the Oracle database, that will go and get stored in the SBase database in the multi-dimensional cubes. So that will be very much supportive for just online reports. On the fly, you will be able to generate the reports. Anyway, we'll be working on this part also. At the time, we'll discuss more and more, and we'll look into that more detail level. So these are the few points you have to understand when you talk about Fusion architecture. Okay, the application tier and middleware tier and database tier. These are the three we have. This all comes under middleware components. This all we call as middleware components. The entire application, that the third party integration, will take place through middleware only by using the respective component. And if you are going to work on these applications, the controls, the security, complete security, you can build with these applications only. I can say these applications, IDM and APM. Here only you can build okay, how the user can have access to each application, read only, read and write, modify privileges, all you can set up from here. Even custom roles definition, all you can set up from here based on this middleware, these components only, the user will have access to respective application. So any questions on these few points you can raise, we can discuss on that. Any questions on this? So going forward, definitely we have to touch. So whatever you have to learn, like OOM, IDM, APM, BPM, UCM, all we'll look into that. But SO and BPL, it's not part of a functional consultant job. So, but I'll just take you through the basic flow, how they do and all. Just I'll present a few slides related to how the integration takes place. But we cannot do that. That's not our job and we never do that. So I'll just give you the good information for your better understanding. So any questions on this future architecture, you can just raise that point. We can talk on that. Any questions here? Any questions?
So on the Oracle database and NetSuite database, you know, I mean, is it the same data being replicated or is it different repository that we just take it, you know, on demand?
Okay. Yeah. See here, when I talk about the Oracle database, that transaction which you record in, say, for any application, it will go and sit as this. But when you talk about, see, after any question, if you can mute from your friend. Meantime, I'll be answering still. If any cross question, you can unmute and you can ask me. Yep, fine. Thank you. Fine. So in Oracle database, what are the transaction you record that will get stored as this? When I talk about S-Base, the complete information is not going to stored in S-Base database. So say as per S-Base, okay, take simple example in Oracle database, say for example, you are recording one journal. Okay, so journal will have a header information. Okay, so batch, it will have one column in the database, batch name and journal name, and each and every field which you see in the front end, for everything will be having a column in the database. But when you look at S-Base database, there won't be any table. So what is the key information out of your transaction? The respective dimensions will be there. As a part of journal, you will have a currency. Currency you see as a one dimension in S-Base database. Okay, and you'll be having accounts. Okay, you will have a segments. Okay, each segment system will take as one dimension. And period it will take as one dimension. Okay, so balance types, actual, encumbrance and budget, it will take as one dimension. Just system is not going to take what is your batch name and journal name and other fields which you see as a part of journal, which is a key information which is really required to generate the reports. So that information only it will be taking as a dimensions. So the balances will go and store in the S-Base based on those dimensions only. So say in the March month, in so-and-so currency, how much balances with respect to account. This is how it will store. So summarized information, that's what we generally call as, in the S-Base database will be storing the balances with respect to dimensions, where the balances should get linked and on what base the balances we may fetch and see in terms of reporting requirements. That's how it will store. Very specific fields information only will be stored in the S-Base database. Those specific fields only we will generally refer as dimensions. Okay.
If I need a transactional data, I still have to go to the Oracle database.
Yes,
right?
Exactly. Transactional data you can get always from Oracle database.
Thank you.
Yep. Fine. So see, all the time you'll be connecting to Oracle database only. Only in case of Hyperion reporting, one of the future which we have as a part of GL, only in that case we'll be using the S-Base database. When we are working on payables, receivables and all the other applications, always we'll connect to Oracle database only. Okay, S-Base only to support the Hyperion reporting, which is a part of GL, which is replaced by FSG, that's all. Okay, any other questions on this, please?
What are the technical aspects of this Fusion applications?
Okay.
If you want to make customization, so do we go with ADF forms and stuff?
Yeah, yeah. I'm just coming to that point also. I just mentioned that also as a one of the concept to discuss today. Yeah, we'll definitely will talk on that. Yep. We'll talk on that. What is the scope for technical people and how things are happening? What functional people may have to learn? These points also we'll discuss. Okay, any other questions on this? Right. Yeah.
We'll be discussing in detail on APM, right? Authorization Policy Manager, that role, template, and everything that you.
Yeah, I'll show you everything. I'll take
okay.
you there. I'll just open the template and I'll show you what are the roles we have and why the Oracle is adding. If we are not going to add, what will happen? The moment you create the primary ledger or business units, what system will do? Okay, because of that APM role templates, how to create the new roles and how to add to this template. When you are adding, what are the other points you have to consider? Everything I'll take you through. See, after this training, if you are going to work as a Fusion Financial Consultant, you won't be having any challenges. Okay, how you work in EBS, the same you'll be able to work on Fusion after this training. That I'll make sure that I'll take that responsibility, no doubt.
Okay,
you may not ask certain things, you may not ask, but of course you'll be in the position to ask, no doubt, since you are EBS expert, you can just correlate, okay, here we'll do like that, Lakshman, how we do in Fusion. Definitely will be asking, but before that, I'll take my responsibility. Yep, fine. Any other questions on this? Fine, if no question, just we can move on to next point. See the same slide I given here. You can just look into that. This is the Fusion architecture. This is the application layer. Here we have all the application, Fusion Financial, Fusion HCM, Human Capital Management, Fusion Procurement, and Fusion Projects. Basically, Fusion Projects we call as PPM, Project Portfolio Management. In EBS, we have all the applications like project accounting. Along with that, we have a project management contracts. Project resource management, we have all applications they grouped and they named here as a PPM, project portfolio management. As a part of PPM, we'll have all projects related applications. Okay, these are the different applications which you are calling as application layer. This is a Fusion middleware. Okay, this is a Fusion middleware layer. Here on we'll be having all our applications. Okay, so see here Oracle Identity Manager and all other applications, other whatever the components we discuss, all will be part of this one. And here Oracle database. They're given as a Oracle Fusion application schema, Oracle middleware schema. Here just the representation they're given, the reality, those are the two databases we'll be having as a part of that. Okay, this is all about Fusion architecture. And these are the Fusion applications like financial management and human capital management, just as information I mentioned, anyway, we'll discuss on that before we get into the application. Supply chain management, project portfolio management, PPM, procurement, customer relationship management. Okay, so this is how we have, and this is a point like technical resource scope in the Fusion applications. See here, when I talk about, so when you are doing any just traditional implementation EBS, okay, in case of EBS implementation, definitely we have to depend on technical resource for primarily data conversions. Okay, data conversions, we have to depend on technical resource in EBS, but in case of Fusion, that is not required. In Fusion, data conversions can be done by functional people. Okay, data conversions can be done by functional resource, but in case of EBS, data conversion should be done by technical only. Technical. That means in Fusion, to do the data conversions, we don't need any technical resource. You tell me, apart from data conversions, which really important job which need to be executed by technical resource, maybe reports, maybe third party integrations. Okay, so primarily when you look at the technical resource, what reason we need technical resource as a part of any implementation? One is data conversions. Other one is third party integrations. Other part is reports, customizations, and form customizations. Very high level. Okay, these are the 4 points. In Fusion, the Fusion application data conversions. Okay, we don't need any technical resource. Okay, so technical people we don't require. This can be done by functional consultant. Anyway, we'll be working on that. I'll show you how to do the complete. We'll execute all the how to load the suppliers. Will be just I'll show you the complete process. I'll show you the results also. We'll come complete process. We'll execute and open invoices. How to load and how to load the customer data. How to load the open invoices in receivables and how to load the assets. All the information we'll see. And third party integrations in case of Fusion. So definitely they should have a knowledge on SOA, service oriented architecture. To report, to do the reports customization in the Fusion, the person who knows BA, okay, BA publisher or BA reports, they can do that report customizations. In Fusion, to do the form customization, they should know ADF. Okay, ADF technology they know, but nowadays the most of the implementations are just happening with this model, SaaS model. That is the reason there is no scope of doing the form customizations. Okay, data conversions, anyway, any functional consultant can do it. The third part integrations, normally in any project what we do, will be taking the separate consultant for this third part integrations. And reports and all, nowadays just it's a completely separate part. So what companies are asking is they're asking the functional people, why don't you learn and start working on BA reports also, since you are expert in all the other areas except reports. Okay, that's how that the version is working in the market and the projects. The people who are working as a functional consultants, they are in few projects. I don't say in all projects functional people only just doing the reports customizations. I can see in the 50% the same consultant is learning and start working on the BA reports also. In some projects you can see they'll be taking the BA expert to do the BA customizations. Since form customizations are not required in case of SaaS model, since that doesn't support, so there is no scope to do the customizations. And if third party integrations are required, then only SOA consultant we require, otherwise not required. Finally, in the very kind of vanilla implementations and all, so we don't need technical consultant. That's how things are working. So that is the scope of technical consultants. Frankly speaking, in the market, the guys who are working as technical consultants, slowly they are just converting into functional side. They started learning HCM or procurement or SCM or finance, other areas. So just they are moving. Even after moving this side also, still they can utilize their expertise in terms of BA reporting and all. If they get an opportunity of working on PaaS or IaaS model of implementations, anyway, they'll be there to do the form customizations with the ADF technology. And apart from that, when you talk about SOA and all, normally the technical people don't involve in that. Again, that is a middleware part. Who are expertized on middleware components, they'll be working. But if somebody is interested, who knows BA and ADF, if they want to learn SOA or BPL or etc., now no one will stop us. Just we can see still people who are trying to acquire the knowledge on SOA, who are technical consultants in case of EBS. Okay, so these are the few points to understand the technical role in the Fusion applications as a part of implementation. So any questions on this, please?
We don't use Oracle Data Integrator, ODI.
ODI is required. See, Oracle Data Integrator, why we use to flow the data between the different systems, different applications. We can use it. That totally depends on the requirement. When you want to move the data from one to other applications, in the SOA, we have a different connectors, web services, different options we have. So that is one of the option. That's it. Okay. It's not.
It will not be a part of functional consultant's job, right?
No, it's not. It's purely technical. Okay, that is also part of middleware component only. It's not a part of our job. Okay, I'll show you that. See here, Oracle Data Integrator. Okay, this is also middleware component only. It's not part of functional consultant job. Okay. Any other questions?
Lakshman, on this third party integration, I mean, as per my understanding, EBS can coexist with Fusion as well. So in that scenario as well, we need someone with SOA expertise, or is it already tightly integrated with EBS?
No, not required, because Oracle providing inbuilt solution. Just you can plug and play. That's it. Okay. Because that is
so I can use
limited applications only, because Oracle is owning many products, but for few products only that coexistence is applicable. Now take simple example. Now in the market, you can see everywhere what Oracle is trying to do is they're trying to sell the subscription to the market existing EBS clients. What Oracle is saying, so anyway, you are running you are using EBS release 12. Okay, now why don't you go with a FH, Fusion Accounting Hub? As per EBS, we call as a financial accounting hub, but it's the same FH. When you say FH, it's nothing but financial accounting hub. As a part of Fusion, now simply we are calling as Fusion Accounting Hub. Okay, Fusion Accounting Hub. Now what Oracle is doing is that they are selling many subscriptions to the EBS clients. So they are telling, okay, you can run your entire applications on EBS on-premise only, but why don't you go with FH from Fusion? This we call as coexistence. So you can still continue with your EBS solution on on-premise only, but for reporting, for your reporting requirements, you can go with FH, where Oracle will provide that coexistence solution. You can go and connect, then whatever the data is there in the Oracle database, the data will be just pulled into this cloud FH, okay, and there you can prepare the reports as per your business requirements. This is what
so it is as simple as plug and play as far as integration is concerned.
Exactly the Oracle build solution for that. Again, we don't need to start doing the integration related work, mapping, etc. So since these two products are owned by Oracle, they know very well and they built everything. And just if some client is interested, just they have to take the subscription for FH. Okay, then they'll provide the solution even in the latest versions if you see. So you can just see that integrator also readily available. Just I'll show you just for your information. Meantime, any questions you please ask me. Any questions? Any questions, please? Simple, it's a ready-made solution is available in case of coexistence. See, this is an on-premise instance, on-premise server, EBS. So this you from here, if you want to pull the data into cloud as a part of FH solution, just in the latest versions Oracle given, I think this solution is possible from 12.1.3. From 12.1.3, I guess this is possible in the latest versions. Anyway, you can see that setup financials. See here, Fusion coexistence mapping. Ledger, calendar mapping, you can do automatic system will fetch the data into Fusion cloud. Okay, that's all we have. Any questions here? Fine, if no questions, we can wind up the session for today. Okay, tomorrow we'll talk on few more points which really we have to understand before we get into the application. Okay, so any questions, please?
Mr. Lakshman, for tomorrow's session, you will send a separate link?
Yeah, I'll be sending the separate link. So tomorrow we'll start the session sharp 7:15. Okay, tomorrow I'll be sending the link sharp 7:15. So that's how we'll continue. Maybe maybe for 2-3 classes I'll do that. Later we'll continue. We'll start at sharp 7 only. Okay. So tomorrow I'll be sending the link sharp 7:15. Before 5 minutes we'll be sending. Okay. So that's how it works. Okay. Separate link we'll be sending.
Perfect. Thank you.
So, Lakshman, this demo sessions will continue for one more time, I believe, right? Next time, and then after that, we'll get into the financial training.
See, the guys who are going to continue this batch, for them, this is the first class. That's how I treat. And just who are attending to see how things, and just to know that what exactly the just basic information, for them may be demo. But I treat from my side, this is a batch we started and this is the first class. Maybe it's a demo. Okay.
And these demo sessions, the contents are similar to whatever is uploaded on YouTube, if I'm not wrong, right?
Yeah, correct, correct. Exactly. Those are also taken by me, so almost more or less same. Because here I given the, what I can say here, agenda I given, right? Almost same information you can see there. Very older batches and this latest batches, there could be some slight difference. We added few more points, but for previous batch and prior to that, whatever the batch we run, it's almost same. I think other point I have here, the course content. Okay, talk on this. So when I talk about the course content, yeah, please.
I'm sorry, I think you might be covering that, what I'm asking. I may have missed it, or
how
long is this course? And, you know, I think you have to cover that.
Yeah, I'll talk on this now. Fine. So now in the market, we have a latest version as release 11. Okay. So release 11 version is available in the market. So we'll be giving training. The classes will be running on release 11, as well as you'll get instance access also for release 11 only. That is the latest version. And when I talk about course content, so primarily we'll be focusing on these modules: general ledger, accounts payables, receivables, cash management, and fixed assets. These five modules primarily will be focusing. And Fusion Expense, nothing but I expense. I'll just take you through the basic configuration and transaction flow. I'll just show you what setups need to be done in the Fusion environment to implement Fusion Expense. And we'll set up the approvals for Fusion Expense also, for expense report. And we'll approve, and we'll be interfacing that expense report into payables. Up to that, I'll be showing the cycle. And Fusion Purchasing, we'll do the basic configuration for Fusion Purchasing. And we'll set the PO approvals, and we'll create the purchase order. Based on purchase order, we'll see the invoice creation, the payables. When I talk about Fusion Tax, nothing but EBT. Here we are calling as Fusion Tax. Here also, I'll take you through the basic configuration. And we'll make sure that tax is calculating the payables or receivables based on the configuration. So apart from that, these are the other areas which we have to understand as a separate modules, like Fusion Setup Manager. Means in Fusion, what are the setups you do, you will be doing from FSM only. That will cover, and as we discussed just now, OM, Oracle Entity Manager, and APM, BPM. On these areas also we'll be working on. So apart from that, just I mentioned as some highlights, I'll take you through the enterprise structure definition. Means the complete, when you are working in real time, from where to start. If you have access to fresh environment, where to start, what points you have to consider, all I'll be covering in these classes. And I'll show you how to do the rapid implementation also, because Oracle is providing spreadsheets where you can put the data in the spreadsheet directly, that can be loaded into the system. Based on that system, we'll do the auto configuration. I'll take you through that process. And data imports and exports, it's nothing but you can do the setups in one environment, all you can export, and you can move the same setups to other instance, okay, which we call as configuration packages. I'll show you that, how to do that. And third party integrations, I'll give you the overview, because we cannot do that in this environments, and we are not technical experts. Okay, so I'll take you through the process so that you can have a better understanding. If you want to do third party integrations, what are the different options we have, how it works really in the Fusion application, that information you can get. And I'll just show you that invoice imaging solution. That is a separate part, as a basically it's related to payables. I'll take you through that. Querying the data from database, anyway, we will see when we are working on the basic BA reports definitions. And BPM approvals will be covering. And the entire course will be, just the classes will be running by comparing with EBS. I'm not going to say like this is the 10 setups we have to do, 12 setups we have to do, and then we can create invoice payment and all. Whatever we are going to discuss, whatever we are going to see in the system, everything will compare with EBS. That's how it will be better understanding for us. If you have any questions then and there, you can ask me. We can discuss on that. No objections on that. And we'll be running the classes based on the fresh environment. Fresh environment, why I mentioned, of course, the sessions, whatever I'm going to run, I'm not going to consider existing setups. I'm not going to show, see, this is how setups can be done. As already setups are done, let's proceed and all. I'm not going to take those examples, those are practice. Here, whatever we do, everything will be doing based on what setups we are going to do. So completely we'll be building the enterprise. Say if you talk about EBS, we'll create our own multi-org structure. Within our multi-org structure, when you are working, that is the reality when you are working in the real time, right? In the same way, here also we'll do in the same ways, on the same way. Okay, that's what I'm mentioning, that two later question will be running. If you look into that detailed setups, general ledger, these are the basic setups, and these are the different concepts which you are going to cover. Okay, including revaluation, translation, consolidations, FRS, all the reports and all these all will be covering. In case of payables, these are the basic configuration we'll be covering. And these are the different concepts we'll be doing everything. The configuration as well as process. Everything we'll do required setups and we'll be testing. That's how we'll run all the classes. And this will be related to configuration. These are the different concepts we are going to cover.
Okay, Lakshman, I'm not sure if it is only me, but you're breaking, I believe, in between.
Okay, give me 1 second.
It's pretty much for everybody, I guess, you know. I also have the same issue.
Yeah, maybe some network related things.
Yeah. And now still if you find the same issue, please let me know. I did something. Okay, that should support. Fine. When you talk about receivables, these are the concepts we are going to cover as a part of receivables. Sorry. So yeah,
that's Lakshman, still your voice is breaking.
Okay, just give me a minute. I'll switch to other network. Okay, fine. So we talk about receivables. These are the basic configuration we do in the system, and these are the different concepts or say futures which we'll be covering within the receivables. Okay, and the part of cash management, this and all we'll do manual automatic reconciliation, external transactions and reconciliation part, and FA, these are the setups we'll do, and these are the different concepts which we'll be covering as a part of this course. And the fusion expense, those are the basic setups we'll do, and we'll see this transaction process, the creation of expense reports and approving and importing into AP. And as a part of purchasing, these are the basic setups we have to execute. And based on that, we can create the purchase orders, approving and creating invoice based on the PO. And fusion tax related setups and process and FSM, functional setup manager. Anyway, in the upcoming 2-3 sessions, we can understand these FSM and all. So OIM and APM, BPM, what we'll be doing. I didn't write very much detail level. I didn't write here, we'll do the invoice approvals, journal approvals, PO approvals. I didn't write. It's a simple high level I written, approval groups and approval rules definition. And very basic, basic level I written. I didn't write very much detail level, and we'll be working on the system. Okay, this is the course content which we designed for this program. If you have any questions on this or on this course or any other questions, you can ask me now.
So Lakshman, I guess as the course would be covering pretty much everything as far as the, for example, Oracle exams or Oracle training is concerned, all the contents would be covered. So if you want to take up any certification, I think by the end of this course, we should be comfortable taking those up, right?
Yeah. One point here, if I ask the question, the guy who is working as a finance consultant for last 3-4 years, frankly speaking, the guy cannot go on to clear the exam. Separate preparation is required. The same works here also. So after completing this training, you can start working as a consultant. I cannot promise on you can go and clear your exam. Okay. So for that, you need separate preparation. If you are looking for that sort of help, I can help you on that. Okay. That I can include it as a part of
this. We will be doing the preparation. I just want to make sure that this will cover pretty much all the aspects of Oracle Financial as well, and then we can enhance based on that.
Yes. Definitely. On top of it, you have to look after certain things to give an exam. That's it. If
do you have any mock exams, Lakshman, with you, I mean, on those terms?
See, if you are looking for this certification and all, I have some information with me. I can share with you. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah.
Lakshma?
Yeah.
You are going to share these recordings to us, or?
Yeah. Yeah. I'll share.
Every day.
Every day after.
Every day or one.
Every day after session.
Okay. If in between, if we miss some classes, if we go for vacation somewhere.
Yeah.
You can attend next batches, no?
Yeah, definitely, definitely. You are allowed. Any batch you can attend in future also.
Okay. Okay. Just for clarification.
Yeah.
Hey, Lakshman, is that cover with your advanced collections, trade management and everything?
No.
Or is that separate?
No.
Do you think?
Yeah, we are not covering as a part of this. Just if you need some
talk, yeah, but the fundamental is same, right? The actual fundamental will work on this fusion also, it's at a different way.
Yeah, yes, yes, it works. It works. If you need some document and all, I can provide you, which talks about the configuration of advanced collections. I can share with you.
Okay.
It's not part of our course.
Okay.
But
thanks.
If you're looking for, I can. Yep.
Okay.
Yeah.
Typically, how long is this curriculum, Lakshman?
Okay.
2 weeks, 3 weeks.
Not 2 weeks, 3 weeks. See, it will be around 60 to 70 hours. Because again, this training for the only the guys who has experience or knowledge on Oracle Fusion Oracle R12 financials or 11i. It can be 11i or R12. If somebody is here to attend these classes as a fresher and all, it won't work. I don't suggest for them. So I don't recommend for them, because it's only for the guys who has experience or knowledge. At least there should be profile. They should have a profile of technical consultants. Okay, for them it works. For freshers, it won't work. So for them only, it takes around 60 to 70 hours. That means we are going to touch that much detail level, whatever we have to understand being a finance functional consultant.
So Lakshman, this Fusion Financial would be pretty much similar to R12 concepts as well, if I understand correctly. So you think that if somebody is, let's say, from distribution background, and hasn't worked in finance as much, they should first, you know, go through R12 and just understand the basic concept before starting this, or even parallelly. Will that work?
No, better. See, because tomorrow, if I'm going to talk about primary ledger, and if I'm going to talk about reporting ledger, secondary ledger, if you know those purposes, then you can attend. Okay. So if you are not aware of those,
right,
it will be a bit critical. See, because here I am not going to talk about what is the purpose of primary ledger, because the guys who are from EPS, they know very well, who are finance consultants, what
right.
is the meaning of primary ledger and all. I am not going to explain what is the primary ledger, how that can be created here. But if there is some new concept which you don't see in EBS, definitely I'll be explaining what is the purpose, or where it will come into the picture, what we can do. These are all points I'll be explaining. Whatever we have in EBS, okay, generally which everybody come across when they are there, when they're working, or at least when they are learning, those points I'm not going to focus on that more and more to explain again. Okay, many people don't like it, right? That is the reason I'm not going
yeah.
to just
right.
run these classes like for beginners.
Yeah, that's fair enough. Yeah,
yeah.
Right. One more question, actually. You mentioned that you will be covering some part of purchasing to support the account payable cycle.
Correct.
Right? Is that also applicable for account receivables? Will you be creating order cycles, sales order?
No. That we didn't cover. That we are not going to cover.
Okay. So account receivable will stand with standalone manual invoices.
I have to touch that inventory, because the SCM solution is not same as the EBS. They brought like product management. Now in the Fusion, you cannot create
right.
items in inventory, and we have to do many setups. That background work we have to do, then only we can start working on OM. Now here we are calling as a order orchestration. So there are many setups which you have to do to support. That is the reason I didn't mention. But if time permits, I'll try. But I'm not promising on that. Whatever I mentioned, the course content, that I'll be covering. If any possibility, if I find from my side, just I'll try to cover that part also, but I'm not promising on that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks. So